Hi everyone, my name is Tudor Mitev, and in this lecture titled The Chronic Task of Sorting Information Flows in Liquid Labor, I want to continue exploring the nature of the network society paradigm and specifically focus on the way the modality and logic of information flows in global information networks inform work life and the nature of labor. So in the lecture I will start with quickly retracing the paths that I already covered in previous lectures on the notion of the network paradigm. Then I want to dedicate some time on discussing this notion of network transaction costs, which is really important to understand in order to understand the logic of the changes that were wrought by the arrival of the new network paradigm economy as it appeared initially here and there in the 70s and the 80s, and then globally in the 90s and the early 2000s. And finally, I will dedicate some time on exploring the way the new economy formats labor and life as such in global information networks. All right, so let's start with retracing our steps and charting the essence of the network paradigm. So first, as a reminder, we have the appearance of global information networks with the arrival of the telegraph, right? So this is the first communication technology which allows the building of these networks of iron, these nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. And as the New York Tribune exclaims, we have the magnetic telegraph acting is literally thought, and which flies as swift, absolutely annihilating space and running in advance of time. A network of nerves of iron wire, where everything happens instantly. And the key emerging tropes arriving with the normalization of these networks of nerves of iron wire, these information networks spanning the globe, is the fact that information is decoupled from matter, the compression of space-time, the emergence of a global information network with everything it portends, and the ability to exercise coordination and control globally in real time. So when it comes to the extraction of information from matter, we have this trope of extraction and processing and sorting of information, right? Because information is now decoupled, it's free, right? It's rendered free. Hence, its extraction and processing and sorting is a key trope in this new paradigm. And we will return to this down the track in this lecture. Then we have this compression of space and time, which naturally leads to the obliteration, the circumvention of borders, and we will return to this because this is a very, very profound experience and a trope with profound implications, going far beyond what you would normally think when it comes to borders. And then we have the homogenization of time and space, right? Everywhere the same, because information flows everywhere with the same rhythm. We have the arrival of a global information network and the ability to coordinate at global scale and exercise control in real time globally. Initially, these networks are highly centralized in what we described previously as star-shaped topologies with many different nodes connecting to one central hub, to one central processing node which allows the network to operate. So this kind of topology, this kind of architecture of the network is highly hierarchical, because we have very hierarchical relationship between the center and the peripheral nodes, but it's also highly efficient because all flows go from the center to the nodes, right? Or reverse, there's no other flow. We also discussed how Paul Byron's invention of a decentralized network, his ARPANET concept, of a network which has no central hub, designed to operate while broken and assumed to be unreliable, inefficient at all times, was revolutionary because it led to, in effect, the emergence of a decentralized and then distributed network, which we now call the internet. And what was so special about this network is that control was distributed to the node, to the what we now call users. Information could be processed, decisions could now be made at what was until recently the periphery of the network, and information flows could flow in all sorts of different ways. In fact, information with the arrival of the internet and the TCP/IP protocol becomes independent of the infrastructure over which it runs, right? So we have the emergence of personal computing, the arrival of the first personal computers in the early 80s, and then the emergence of this multiplicity of connected computers spanning the globe, portending the arrival of cyberspace, right? Described as a more ecosystem than machine, a bioelectronic environment that is literally universal. And following that, we have this conceptualization coming from Manuel Castells of the arrival of a network society. He's describing the society which already then in the early 2000s was in place and which we all inhabit. This is a society whose social structure is made of networks powered by microelectronics based information and communication technology. So we have a merger of the social and communication structure. A society, a network society, is a society which is basically operating at that merged state of the social structure and the communication structure. And this in turn is coupled, and it's bringing us to the topic for this lecture, is coupled with a completely new type of economy emerging. One that is based entirely on knowledge. A third wave economy is described by Esther Dyson and Alvin Toffler, an economy where actionable knowledge is the primary unit of value, as it were. An economy in which information, as Stuart Brand prophesied already in the 80s, both wants to be free and wants to be expensive. So the network society and the network society paradigm which we inhabit is characterized by a social structure made of information networks, a global bioelectronic environment, as this merger of our bodies, as it were, and the communication infrastructure, a paradigm in which logically the central resource is actionable knowledge, because it is built, the entire structure of the network society is built out of information flows, as it were. It's also characterized by a binary logic of inclusion and exclusion, because if you are not participating in the network, you are completely invisible, right? You're not participating in the flow of information and in the processing and sorting of information. And the strategic space of that paradigm where it unfolds and where its strategic battles are waged is in people's minds. Why? Because its central resource is actionable knowledge. All right, so having the parameters of the network society paradigm in place, now let's continue into this fascinating concept of the transaction costs of networks. And this concept is really important for us because understanding it, and specifically understanding the logistics of how networks perform themselves into existence, especially in situations of adversity, especially in situations where an organization, being a network, has to deal with a complex and rapidly changing external environment, allows us to understand the logic of why the new emergent economy looks in this way, not in that way, why certain network organizational patterns and topologies are preferred to others. So what does transaction cost mean? So first of all, the thing to understand is that every network, when formed, and this applies, by the way, both to individuals imagined as networks and to social groups and to large network organizations, which might be localized in space and time or might be spread globally. Every one of these entities, if we understand it as a network, has to continuously deal with the adversity of its external environment. The way American military theorist John Boyd describes this is that in a real world of limited resources and skills, individuals and groups form, dissolve, and reform their cooperative or competitive postures in a continuous struggle to remove, overcome physical and social environmental obstacles. Right? So we have a situation of continuous struggle with an external environment. And this is really important to understand. No network exists in a complete isolation from its environment. No network exists in a vacuum, as it were. Networks, in fact, which operate in a vacuum are subject to a very intense entropy and fall apart very fast because they do not have any external exchanges with an outside environment, and their internal cohesion, internal structure literally collapses. So that engagement with an external environment is really important. It's fundamental for the continuous existence of a network. However, when you take this on board, when you really understand what this means, the fact that a network has to perform itself in existence in adverse, rapidly changing complex environments, then the way, again, John Boyd describes this, actions and decisions become critically important. Why is that? Because actions must be taken over and over again and in many different ways. And all sorts of different scenarios have to be continuously tested against reality. Decisions must be rendered to monitor and determine the precise nature of the actions needed that will be compatible with the goal. And what John Boyd is doing here is he is analyzing literally the logistics, the mechanics, step by step, of the process of understanding an external reality, deciding on a course of actions, and acting in an external complex, often adverse reality. To make these timely decisions implies that we must be able to form mental concepts of observed reality as we perceive it, and be able to change these concepts as reality itself appears to change. This is really interesting because, and I want to underscore this, every network, no matter how simple, how complex, and every organization that uses, for example, information network to perform its internal communications, right, has to deal with the adversity of an outside environment. And John Boyd synthesized this process. He developed this notion of an OODA loop, a loop that he synthesized from this process of figuring out one's environment and deciding on appropriate course of action, then observing the results of that action, and then again figuring out, again orienting oneself in that environment. So he describes this process as a OODA loop, as observe, orient, decide, act loop. And his conceptualization allows for fast decision making in complex environment. He was a fighter pilot, so his initial impetus to develop this concept was because was informed by his experiences in the Korean War. And down the track in his career in the United States Air Force and in the military, he became a legendary as the theorist of this process of fast decision making, continuous cycles of feedback and response based on analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. And his notion of the OODA loop is studied by management and organizations globally, and adopted again globally because of its invariable insights about the very process, again, the mechanics of adaptation in a complex environment. As you can see, I'm emphasizing continuously this notion of complexity of an outside environment and the mechanics of adaptation. How does this relate to transaction costs? From the perspective of where we started the network society and the network society paradigm, the key question is, understanding what we understand now about the emergence of the network society, how to coordinate a large information network in real time over a distance, right, in space and time. How to coordinate in real time in an adverse environment. And initially, as we already established, these large information networks were invariably centralized, right? So these were star-shaped architectures, centralized topologies, hierarchical and very efficient because of the efficient flow of information within them. And the way this kind of network, so we're talking about centralized hierarchical organizations, right? I'm using organization and network interchangeably to help you understand that when we talk about networks, we're also talking about organizations. So when a centralized hierarchical network encounters reality, it always encounters it at what I call the periphery of the network. So these are these nodes that are distributed, these nodes that are distributed around that central hub, which makes the decisions. Right? So usually these are the nodes that encounter the reality. They detect that something has changed. So the reality is encountered at the periphery of the network because these nodes form the periphery. And what happens next is that the data that is gathered by the peripheries invariably sent, communicated to the center for orientation and decision, because it is the center only in a star-shaped topology that can perform orientation and decision. Only the center can process the information that is gathered and make decisions based on it. And after the center has performed those actions, it then communicates appropriate responses back to the periphery, and the periphery executes them, right? So if you think of a highly centralized hierarchical organization, this is exactly how it acts. Something happens on ground level, and then the organization has to react. And how does this reaction look like? So something has happened, some incident or whatever, and then the person, the functionary, the worker, whatever you want to call that node in the network, communicates that something has happened to the center, right? To central administration or to senior management, right? So this is the center where orientation and decision is performed. And then senior management has to make the decision and communicate it back to that node, to the periphery, in order for the periphery to be able to act based on this something that has happened, right? So this is more or less how the process looks like in complex organizations that are hierarchical and centralized. And here we come to the essence of what transaction costs actually mean. Because remember, we're presuming that that every network, every organization, no matter how no matter what its focus might be or how it's positioned in the world, has to act in a changing environment, often in a very complex environment with many different moving parts. And the key thing here in that process that I just described of the network reacting to something happening is that there is a cost in coordinating the flow of information. And that cost you could describe both in terms of time and also in terms of energy or you know, in terms of monetary cost for that matter, right? Because just purely in terms of time, that stimulus, something that happened at the edge of the network, at the periphery, has to travel to the center. The center has to orient itself, make a decision based on the stimuli it received, right? So again, what is communicated is very important. Think in terms of people in the field reporting back to senior management on whatever happened. So people having to write reports about what happened and sending those reports to middle or senior management. This in itself is what a transaction cost looks like, right? Because if you have to write reports, this means that you are not able to make decisions on your own, right? You have to send information for someone else to make a decision for you, right? So there is a cost in coordinating the flow of information between the nodes in the network, right? And this cost can be expressed in many different variables. Crucially, and this is really important to understand, the more nodes you add to the network, so think in terms of the more admin staff in an organization or the more workers in an organization, right? The more nodes you add in this type of centralized hierarchical network, the more you scale it up, right? It increases in scale, is what how we describe it. And now, this kind of hierarchical centralized network starts experiencing rapidly increasing coordination costs as it scales up. Why? Because each new node being added to the network, it adds exponentially to these transaction costs of the maintenance of the flow of information between the nodes in the network, right? So in explained in other words, the more admin staff you add to an organization, the more you increase the transaction costs in that organization, or the more frontline staff you add to organization. Again, you no matter what type of staff you add, the more nodes you add to a highly centralized hierarchical network, the more you increase the strain of processing information and routing information flows within the network. Again, remember, this is in the context of a centralized hierarchical network. So we have very high costs of coordinating the flow of information. But that is not all, because we also have another problem. We have the coordinating of the cost of coordination of information flows when the network scales up in space. But we also have the cost of controlling the network's interactions in time, in a complex and changing environment, right? Because the coordination happens internally, but the control is in terms of the externals of the network. So how the network reacts or engages with its external environment. And the faster that external environment changes, the faster naturally the network has to adapt. Because if the network is unable to adapt to a quickly changing external environment, that network starts very quickly to experience catastrophic failure, initially on a local level and then globally, and then the network collapses. Why catastrophic failure? Because its absence of adaptation leads to inexplicable actions happening to the network. So the network cannot control its environment. It cannot understand what is happening to it, right? And inevitably, this leads to what is this? What we describe as entropy, right? The second law of thermodynamics kicks in. And so the network literally starts falling apart because of these rising costs of control. And crucially, again, the more centralized and hierarchically organized network we're dealing with, the higher its control costs when it comes to the external environment, because its center, no matter how capable for example, if we're talking about organization, no matter how capable its management team is, no matter how capable its processing power is for that matter, is always limited when it comes to the complexity of the external environment. And invariably that center is overwhelmed, by the speed of change. So invariably, the center finds itself having to dramatically increase its control costs. Again, centralized networks, realities encountered at the periphery, all information has to flow to some sort of center for processing and orientation and decision, and then flow back to the periphery. And as a result, we have very high transaction costs. And again, a reminder, all networks have transaction costs, all organizations have transaction costs, and this can be explained in terms of energy or time or money for that matter. And these costs are always twofold. They can be explained, can be explained as an equation with two parts. We have the cost of coordinating the flow of information within the network and the cost of controlling the network's interactions with the outside, with that complex and changing environment. So we have transaction costs as a concept now, and we have a nascent bubbling understanding of how centralized networks really struggle with transaction costs. Because all coordination, all control, all decisions have to be performed in the center. And now contrast this notion of a centralized network, centralized topology as described by Baran, with decentralized and distributed networks. Observe what changes. Observe, for example, the dramatic shift when it comes to transaction costs, when it comes to the shift from centralized to decentralized, let alone to fully distributed. And what I'll do now is I'll give you an example when it comes to that shift from centralized to decentralized. And the example I'll give you is from this notion of Blitzkrieg, which emerged in the Second World War. It was popularized by the German armies, the Wehrmacht's use of very unique for the time tactics that I have described as decentralized coordination at scale and decentralized control at speed. And the philosopher, the architect of those tactics, was a German general called Heinz Guderian, whose nickname was Schneller Heinz, which in German means the fast Heinz. And we will discover why. So Guderian's philosophy and rules of thumb, as it were, for what he described as his Panzerwaffe, which means his armored forces, was these rules of thumb were built on, at for the time, revolutionary premises. So first he argued that every tank must have a radio. Why? From our purposes, for our, I'm translating this to our discussion, every node can broadcast as an effect and communicate with the network, right? So every tank a commander, literally, and in that picture you can see an armored Panzerwaffe column somewhere in southern Russia in 1941 during the German invasion of the Soviet Union. Every tank commander has, in effect, the ability to communicate with every other tank commander in the vicinity, right? So you have an expedited flow of information between the nodes in the periphery without involving a center, right? Every tank commander can receive immediately, directly commands from the center, right, at once. So this is a revolutionary concept for that time. No one else practiced anything like that. Furthermore, Guderian argued for something even more revolutionary, right? A delegation of authority to local commanders. And what he understood by that term is that decision-making within that specific, division, or within that armored brigade, or even smaller groupings, should be left to the local commanders at that specific periphery, right? So they should be authorized to make important decisions, or even more importantly, to countermand orders. So from our perspective, this is a decentralized decision-making which in turn allows coordination and control at speed. Why? Because there is no need for information to flow to the center for orientation and decision and processing, right? It is done locally at that spot. Furthermore, Guderian prioritized mobility and speed above all else, right? So he trained his commanders and inculcated them with that culture of mobility being a value in its own. So the ability for the network to react fast to a changing environment and to move fast within a changing environment, right? So the network is optimized to adapt in a complex and changing environment. What is more, and in that regard, Guderian also always led by example, as you can see in this image. He argued that local commanders must always lead from the front, and he always as well led from the front in his commander's tank or armored vehicle. He was always together with the frontline units at the bleeding edge of the division. So what this means in our terms is that the decision-making node, so whoever is making the decision in that specific unit, must be in constant contact with the adversary network, with the outside environment, in order to optimize those transaction costs, in order to speed up decisions, in order to lower the control costs. So local commanders must lead from the front. And finally, he and the German general staff at that time had this fascinating concept that in German is described as Auftragstaktik, which means strategic mission-based orders. So in practice, this meant that instructions to local commanders or to the local nodes in the network were always very broad and always very general, allowing the local commanders to make interpretations on their own and giving them tremendous freedom of action, tremendous freedom of decision-making. So in our terms, nodes in contact with the adversary network have broad autonomy in interpreting orders, right? So nodes are allowed to make their own decisions, right? And to initiate actions on their own without waiting for confirmation from the center. Again, think in terms of transaction costs. So in effect, what emerges here, and the German armed forces were arguably the first, the Wehrmacht specifically, right? Land armed forces were arguably the first large organization able to introduce massive decentralization at scale, successfully initially, until they ran into an even larger organization which was able to do the same, which is the Soviet Army in the later years of the Second World War. So let's examine the logic of decentralization here, because it's really fascinating. So we have a large hierarchical organization, because the armed forces are pretty much the most hierarchical organization you can imagine, adopts decentralized decision making. So it even though the formal structure of the network is highly centralized, its culture of action, and the especially when it comes to these frontline units where Guderian was, and its culture of communication is inculcated with this notion of decentralized decision making. Furthermore, we have a culture of fast orientation, adaptation, and action in adverse environment, right? So, and I emphasize that this is a culture, so this is something that can be adopted as a way of thinking about the world organizationally, I emphasize, as a network, and also as a way of acting in the world organizationally and as a network. As a corollary of that, those local decision centers, those local commanders in the field, necessarily given a very broad autonomy to make their own decisions, to interpret the orders in whatever way they want, and are encouraged to take risks, they are encouraged to experiment. their orders, this notion of Auftragstaktik, is they're told what to do, so they're given a strategic objective, but they're not told how to do it. They're not given a description of the process, right? So they're told what to do, but not how to do it. And if you look at footage or even still images from those early years of the Blitzkrieg in action, there are several things that you should be able to immediately see here and relate to our discussion of network transaction costs. Like, for example, in this image, the thing that I want to underline is the fact that every unit is mechanized and they're all moving with what appears to be the same speed. The tanks are mechanized, but also the infantry is mechanized. The commanders are also moving together with them, and everything is happening at speed, right? So you have what is in effect a massive maneuvering network being mobile and moving in an adverse environment, right? With a culture of fast decision-making, fast observation, fast reaction, and all these other characteristics that we already described. And what emerges from this, and I'm linking now to the way we started this section of the lecture with John Boyd's observation about the OODA loop, what emerges here is that speed and the ability to react fast in a changing environment is fundamental, right? And as we already observed, only networks with low transaction costs can operate really fast in a rapidly changing environment. And the faster a network gathers data from the field, that is, observes reality and analyzes it into meaningful information, that is, orients itself in reality, the faster is decision making, that process of deciding, which in turn gives it the opportunity to act beyond an opponent's cognitive level, beyond the opponent's ability to perceive what is happening. Why? Because the opponent experiences rapidly rising transaction costs. The opponent is also a network, naturally, another organization, right? So the action of that network, in this case, the German Panzerwaffe, during the early years of the Blitzkrieg, overwhelms the opponent. And here you have another example of mechanized units, right? So you see, all you see here is units which are able to move very fast. Everyone has a radio. Everyone is able to communicate. Commanders lead from the front. And John Boyd describes this as this notion of fast transience, that in order to win, the network should operate at a faster tempo or rhythm than the adversary. Or better yet, get inside the adversary's OODA loop or time cycle. And the OODA loop in question looks more or less like this, where reality is continuously experienced at the observation stage, where a network organization perceives its surroundings, it observes its surroundings. So this is something that happens continuously. It's a dynamic process. Simultaneously, it orients itself, and that's the orientation stage already does not involve reality. It happens internally in the organization, right? So it orients itself in the reality it has observed. It makes a decision and then it acts, and acts upon that reality. There is a feedback loop there as well. So the larger and more centralized the network, this is the key takeaway when it comes to transaction costs, the higher its transaction costs, right? Because centralization carries this burden with itself, right? Centralization optimizes and makes highly efficient the flow of information. So think here in terms of political systems, for example. Think how efficient a dictatorship or a monarchy is, right? So everyone knows who is in charge. Everyone knows where the buck stops. Everyone knows who makes the decisions, right? But this kind of highly efficient, highly centralized, highly hierarchical network has extremely high transaction costs because it is very slow to adapt to change in a rapidly changing environment. Right? It's very quickly overwhelmed by change. Right? It's very quickly overwhelmed by complexity because of the cost of communication within the network. Because of the, you remember, transaction cost consists of the cost of coordination within and the cost of control of the network outside in its contact with a changing environment. All right. Now, having established that key concept of transaction costs, let's examine this notion of the new economy. What does the economy look like in the network society paradigm? And as a reminder, the network society paradigm involves a social structure made of information networks, involves a merger of the information network and the social networks, right? Organizational networks. It's a global bioelectronic environment, is in effect, right? Cyberspace, as we already described. Knowledge is the primary, the central resource. And there's a binary logic of inclusion and exclusion. If you are not participating in the network, you do not exist, literally. So the first theorist prophesize the emergence of this type of new economy is Austrian philosopher of management and theoretician of management, Peter Drucker, who coined the notion of the knowledge worker in the 1950s. He coined the notion of the knowledge economy, the knowledge society, the knowledge worker. Why? Because he argued that there is a shift in the mode of production away from industrialized assembly line based labor and production and towards information based labor and production. And concomitantly, knowledge then becomes the critical factor of production. Why? Because when production is based on information, then knowledge is power, literally. Whoever controls knowledge controls power. And if you want to have power in this kind of society, you have access to the centers of information processing and knowledge generation. So in terms of knowledge, in terms of the key economic activities, the shift from industrial to a network society, or what Peter Drucker described as knowledge society, looks as follows. We have industrial labor in industrial society. So everyone is a worker in a factory or in some sort of industry associated with factory work, with the assembly line. Not so in a network society, where everyone is engaged in some sort of knowledge work, in some sort of information processing, and we will examine this in detail in the next section of the lecture. In industrial society, the primary tools of production where power resides are the factory machines and the assembly lines. Not so in the network society, because here we have information machines, computers, and information processing as the primary tools of production. And the way Kevin Kelly frames this is really fascinating. I will read this passage at length. The principles governing the world of the soft, the world of intangibles, of media, of software, and of services, will soon command the world of the heart, the world of reality, atoms, objects, steel and oil, and the hard work done by the sweat of brows. Iron and lumber will obey the laws of software. Automobiles will follow the rules of networks. Smokestacks will comply with the decrees of knowledge. If you want to envision where the future of industry will be, imagine it as a business built entirely around the soft, even if at this point you see it based in the heart. And when you're reading this, this was written in the end of the 90s during the dot-com boom, in a book called New Rules for the New Economy. It's a fantastic book, I highly recommend it. When you're reading this, think about what is happening to automotive production now? Think of, for example, phenomena such as the emergent electric car industry and the self-driving car industry, where you're dealing with basically computers on wheels as opposed to cars with computers in them. And return back to this quote from Kevin Kelly. And that knowledge-based economy has labor practices which are very different from the previous, the industrial-based economy, naturally. So in the words of Peter Bradlow and Richard Reeves, labor practices look different from those in traditional forms of manufacturing. Creative work in particular is much harder to oversee and direct from the top down. The structure itself of the organizations where labor is performed, of companies, changes because of the demands of global information networks, right? And because of the high transaction costs, which we already described. So the creative work in the knowledge-based economy, the economy which we're inhabiting now, requires decentralization because it's much harder to oversee and direct from the top down. And in the words of Peter Drucker, in knowledge work, the first question is, what should you be doing, not how? Now, recall reading this, recall what we established already about Panzerwaffe and Heinz Guderian's Blitzkrieg rules of thumb. Right, this notion of Auftragstaktik, of instructions on what to do, not how to do it, and there should be a deep resonance here, right? Because what I'm pointing at with these quotes is that emergent logic of decentralization, which requires both cultural and organizational changes. And this new economy that we are describing, that we're trying to map here in the context of the network society paradigm, has, according to Kevin Kelly, three distinguishing characteristics. So first and foremost, naturally, it is global. Why? Because information networks themselves are global and the flow of information is global. Secondly, the new emergent economy has favors intangible things, right? It's based on information and on knowledge generation. Hence, it favors ideas and information and relationships. And finally, it is intensely interlinked. And the way Kevin Kelly describes it, these three attributes produce a new type of marketplace and society, a new economy, one that is rooted in ubiquitous electronic networks, right? So here we have again a resonance with this notion of bioelectronics, right? The emergent notion of cyberspace. And what we have to understand here is that from the perspective of our discussion of the rise of global information society, the appearance of this notion of the network society paradigm, and our efforts to describe the new economy that emerges as a result, we have to again face this notion of transaction costs, because the free flow of information demands transaction costs as low as possible, because as we already established, centralized networks, hierarchical organizations really struggle with fast adaptation, really struggle with the speed with which they process information in a fast changing environment. Therefore, they struggle in an environment characterized by global information flows and dramatic changes. Why? Because global information flows require low network transaction costs. And low network transaction costs, in turn, require decentralization, right? They require the ability to make decisions, to process information and act based on that locally, at that place where the network has encountered the need to process and change, not somewhere else far on the other end of the world, perhaps, where the decision-making center is located, right? So we have this logic of decentralization emerging, as a result of the very logic of the existence of a global information network, right? Because again, faced with these rising transaction costs, centralized networks have no choice but to decentralize in order to maintain themselves into existence. And as a result, we have dramatic changes in the way economic organizations, or companies, corporations, governmental structures for that matter, start acting and organizing themselves into existence. So the way Bradley and Reeves describes it is really interesting here. The dynamics of the workplace are being reshaped by the ongoing relationship between networks, often informal, self-organizing, horizontal, opaque, and the official structures of departments, line managers, and appraisers. This is because people are able to work together more easily without the coordinating hand or disciplinary gaze of an organization. In other words, for the optimized information flow within the network here in question, from the perspective of that flow, the actual structure of the network is irrelevant, right? So it's much better for workers to be able to informally organize their own ad hoc communication, decentralized communication network, where they're able to make decisions and enact them, right? Ignoring the official structures of departments, managers, etc. This is really interesting. And again, I want to remind you of the Blitzkrieg notion and the example that we looked at then, because you have the same thing emerging in especially in the 90s with the way organizations find themselves having to either formally or at least informally restructure themselves in reaction to these information networks. And as Charles Leadbeater frames it, open and collaborative models of organization, or rather decentralized networks, will increasingly trump closed and hierarchical models as a way to promote innovation, organize work, and engage consumers. And the reasons for that are obvious, we already discussed them. And as a result, we have an environment emerging that new economic paradigm, as it were, in which new media technologies and all sorts of different organizations and networks are saturated with network forms of organization. So they're saturated with this logic of decentralization. And what is more, something dramatic happens also to their value propositions. So as Mark Dews notices here, suddenly the most successful corporations, the most successful businesses are not those that produce atoms and pieces of metal, right? And this is again something that Kevin Kelly observed already in 1999 in his New Economy book. Suddenly the most valuable corporations start organizing themselves around connectivity, right? So they have, as Mark Dews observed, they share one fundamental characteristic. The product these companies deliver is connectivity, bringing people together to trade, communicate, interact, and exchange knowledge, information, goods, and services. This is a very fascinating problem. Why is connectivity so valuable? And the reason is very simple, actually. Once you understand the logic of this emergent network society, the reason is that you have knowledge work as the primary value proposition, right? Where everything is organized around the production of knowledge. We have information networks spanning the globe, resulting in global information flows. We have that notion of low transaction costs and therefore constant decentralization, where even gigantic global corporations such as Amazon or Google will be operating in a very decentralized manner with very fluid teams. And we have some sort of primary value emerging in the need to sort information continuously, in the need to connect these vast decentralized and distributed networks and their nodes to one another, and to sort the resultant complex information flows. Hence, connectivity becoming key. Hence, the ability to sort information, the ability to aggregate and curate information for different users becomes so valuable, becomes primary. All right, so having understood this, we can now examine what happens to the experience of the individual in all of this change, to the experience of the person having to work, what happens to labor, and what happens to life itself in that environment of rapid information flows, dramatic decentralization, and a network society paradigm. And again, the first thing that we need to remember when we start thinking about the life of the individual and the experience of the worker in this new paradigm is that knowledge and information are the primary form of capital. And this is to be understood literally. You, for example, in the simple and direct example I could give here is if you think of cryptocurrency, it's information itself, right? It's pure information. But on a more abstract level, knowledge generation is literally the primary form of capital production in the network society paradigm. And we already established also that decentralization is key because of the importance of low transaction costs. So all organizational and work models are optimized for efficient information flow, right? And are informed and permitted, infused with this logic of decentralization. And when you think of that, and when you think of flows, it's very important to remember and to truly understand that when it comes to industrial world, you know, the world of the factory, of the unions, the world of the factory worker with the 8-to-4 job, right, and the 1-hour lunch break and the weekend. So these are all concepts that everyone is familiar with, and in the 5-day work week, right? So these are all concepts that everyone is familiar with and that were fought for in bloody battles between unions and factory owners and the police throughout the length of the 19th and early 20th century until they were secured, right? So they permit the industrial paradigm and the logic of the work set to the rhythm of the assembly line. But they're completely alien, and I want to underscore this, they're completely and utterly alien to the notion of knowledge work and to the logic permitting the network society paradigm. Because knowledge work is set to the flow of information, and information does not stop flowing. Right? It cannot stop by definition, axiomatically. The moment information stops flowing, you have the collapse of the information network. So the logic of free information flows, right, the fundamental primary logic of the network society paradigm, demands labor, or the practice of work itself, that is unrestrained by borders, right? So because remember, the information flows are global. So labor itself must be unrestrained by borders. And fundamentally, crucially, always available for work. Why? Because information flows need constant processing, constant sorting, constant decision making, constant action. And as a result, as Marcus describes brilliantly in his Liquid Life piece from 2006, life today has become analogous with work. And it increasingly displays all the contemporary characteristics of work in what has been described as the new capitalism, right? This new economy. Permanent flux, right? Constant change. And structural indeterminacy. Why structural indeterminacy? That's a really interesting concept. Quite simply, because of the logic of decentralization. Right? The structure itself becomes liquid because of the need to continuously change. And we already talked about transaction costs, and we talked about why this logic permits this new paradigm. This is described very nicely also by Melissa Gregg, who is a researcher at Intel Corporation, in her brilliant piece Function Creep. These are employees for whom the boundaries between labor and leisure, so this, we're talking about the knowledge worker here, work and home have blurred to the extent that it has become difficult to describe what actually counts as work. Right, so contrast this with the factory worker, right? So the factory worker has the 5-day working week and the 8-to-4, 9-to-5 working day with a 1-hour lunch break, right? So the factory worker knows at all times what is work and what is not work, what is leisure, what is free time, home time, etc. But look at what is happening here. The boundaries between labor and leisure, work and home have blurred to the extent where the workers cannot describe what actually counts as work. These symptoms are epitomized in the repeated sentiment, "I can't work at work," where employees explain their preference for working from home, away from the distractions of the office, when they really want to get something done. Just think about what this means, right? Think about what this means in terms of unrestrained by borders and always available for work. When we talked about borders previously, it was assumed and it was implicitly suggested that these were geographical borders or state borders. But what we see here are the borders between the home and office space being transgressed. We see the borders between the family and the outside being transgressed, right? Because of the need to be always available. So in effect, we have the obliteration of the borders of the individual. Right, so that notion of the individual space, which is separate and sacrosanct and sovereign from the demands of the office or of the work, is gone. Right, so this boundary is obliterated, as well as the boundary between family and the life within the family, within the home. Right? And the home being sacrosanct and separate, sovereign from the outside. Right? This is transgressed as well. Same with the state and geographical borders as well. And simultaneously, we have again the repetition of this trope of the homogenization of time and space, but now we see it in a very different light. Why so? Because here it stands for the fact that whether the information flows being encountered in an office environment, in the context of the so-called 8-to-4 job, or in a home environment, in the context of leisure at home, right, or time with family, this distinction is blurred, is disappeared in effect, right? It's homogenized, right? We have the same time and space throughout, in which the question is one present and willing to work? In effect, and we're describing here the effects of this new economy, right? In effect, no one is outside anymore. No one is outside of the network. Right? And we talked about the outside, inside, and the binary state here, if you recall. So no one is outside, whether by choice or necessity. This also means that the precarity of contemporary life through media extends to each and every one of us. It takes tremendous effort to be outside, truly. And there are terrible costs associated with making the decision to be outside, because one removes oneself from the flow of information, from the network. One becomes invisible, a pariah, in effect, if one wants to be truly outside. And when one is inside this environment of information flows, when one is inside, we have the emergence of a very strange phenomenon, which Melissa Gregg describes as a presence bleed. So the way she frames it, professional employees increasingly reckon with the condition of presence bleed, where the location and time of one's labor becomes a secondary consideration to the task of managing the expectation and or possibility that one is available and willing to work. Right? So again, remember, homogenization of time and space and obliteration of borders. So in effect, the act of presence itself, this notion of being present in one place and therefore absent from another, right? The boundary between the two itself is obliterated. And is an effect, we have this notion of the presence bleed. You might be here physically, but mentally, and remember, this is where the primary value and the strategic space of the network society paradigm is in the mind. Mentally, that person is not there, actually. They're somewhere else because they have to manage the expectation and possibility that they're available and willing to work. Right? So think here in terms of, watching a movie together with friends or family or being together with friends at a restaurant having the compulsive need to check one's phone, one's mobile computing device, connecting one to the global information network because of that compulsive need to manage the expectation and all possibility that one is available and willing to work. And what is work in this context? It is the management of information. It is the task of processing, sorting, and managing information. And concomitantly here, so we have this notion of the presence split, right? Because we have the dissolution of the boundary between present and absent. One is always present, right? One is in a state of a continuous standing reserve of labor. Remember, labor here is information processing. Concomitantly with that, we have this notion of that Mark Deuce proposes of personal information spaces. The retreat into the personal information space at home and at work, within which we only talk to and within ourselves, right? So when you're experiencing presence bleed while you are, let's say, with friends in a restaurant, automatically you are actually not there. You are in a personal information space, which is you could describe this personal information space as your form within the global information network. You, the node, processing, sorting information, engaging with the flow of information, right? So this is your personal information set. And fundamentally, while in presence bleed, while in the personal information space, one is always talking to oneself, right? Because you are physically, you are only with yourself. You are perfectly atomized and isolated. So what we have emerging here is the parameters of life and labor in this new economy. We have the obliteration of the boundaries between individual and the outside, and family and state and geographical borders. We have the obliteration of the boundaries between presence and absence, the appearance of this notion of the personal information space, which is the space which one represented by one's connection to the global information network, and the resultant homogenization of time and space. And the primary action that, in effect, the worker in this new economy performs is what Melissa Gregg brilliantly terms the chronic task of sorting. Sorting what? Information. Why chronic? Because information doesn't sleep. So the information flows have to be continuously sorted, right? Emails have to be continuously checked. Social media have to be continuously updated and engaged with, right? Customers have to be continuously engaged with online, etc., etc., etc. Information has to be continuously engaged with. And when we talk about sorting, I want to recall this image that we encountered in one of the earlier lectures when we talked about the arrival of the global information network, and we talked about the emergence of completely new jobs, such as the switchboard operators, right? So this is the early years of telephony and switchboard operators who if you recall, initially were young children, but they proved unreliable as operators of these information flows, and then they became invariably women, right? This was one of the first profession open and entirely to women. And in effect, we are all now, without exception, playing the roles of these switchboard operators. All we do is routing information flows, engaging with information and routing it around, processing it, acting based on the information that we've processed. The chronic task of sorting. However, the effects do not stop here of this new economy, the effects on life and labor. Because as the organizational structures flatten and decentralize and, as it were, liquefy, what used to be described as the workforce in the military terminology that was very much in tune with the logic of the industrial society, the industrial paradigm. Now we have the emergence of the type of worker who is an information processor first and foremost, a knowledge generator first and foremost. But simultaneously, this notion of lifelong employment disappears entirely. Because organizations are never stable enough, and never the employment structures are never static enough to allow lifelong employment anymore. The paradigm has changed dramatically. So we have this phenomenon of continuous searching for jobs, preparing for potential future jobs, as well as managing multiple careers more or less simultaneously. These are the core elements of everyday lifestyle for many. So these are the distinguishing characteristics of the new economy and the new type of labor that it generates. Precarious existence. It's a move towards the freelance work, casualization, temporary work, and what we can describe as liquid forms of labor. Like the structure of labor itself liquefies under the onslaught of these information flows which we have been describing, right? In effect, liquid labor emerges. And the typical professions which are typical because they typify this new type of worker are the media professionals, as Mark Deuce very elegantly described. So these are people who are employed in journalism and marketing and communications and advertising and PR, game design, TV, the movie industry. So they all typify this phenomenon of the casualization, the constant precarity, the liquid labor phenomenon. So they embody in their work styles all the themes of social change in liquid modern times. Why? Because they already work entirely and only with information, right? They already work entirely only and only with content, with knowledge. And this notion of liquid life was developed by a Polish sociologist Zygmunt Bauman, and it's probably the best description of the kind of profound fundamental changes that the network society paradigm has brought when it comes to the experience of work and the experience of life itself. So the way he describes it is really interesting. Liquid modern is a society in which the conditions under which its members act change faster than it takes the ways of acting to consolidate into habits and routines. So think here in terms of fast OODA loops, fast transients, the necessity to decentralize, the necessity to be able to have low transaction costs and change under changing conditions, the necessity to continuously be present for information flows and for the processing and sorting of information. Liquidity of life and that of society feed and reinvigorate each other. Liquid life, just like liquid modern society, cannot keep its shape or stay on course for long. Liquid life is a precarious life, lived under conditions of constant uncertainty. And this is pretty much the best description, in my opinion, of where we are now in terms of the new economy brought by the network society paradigm and the new modes of being, the new modes of living and working in that economy, in that paradigm. Liquid life, precarious life, constant uncertainty. So let's try and map everything we've discussed so far in the lecture and try and isolate the key characteristics of this phenomenon. So we have the obliteration of individual, family, state, and geographical borders. We have the homogenization of time and space. And this means the creation of such phenomena as personal information spaces, right, which transgress the other spaces we find ourselves in, and which result in the atomization of us, the individuals who are in those other spaces, because we have to isolate ourselves from the other spaces in order to be in those personal information spaces and process information as part of the global information network. In effect, we have this phenomenon of presence bleed, where our presence in a space stops meaning our absence in some other space, right? Because we have to be continuously present for the global information network in the context of work, right? And the processing of information, because that's what work actually means today. Information processing, sorting of information. And this is the phenomenon of the chronic task of sorting, right? The need to be constantly present because you might be called to sort information. And this in itself, in its entirety, this complex of phenomena leads to a situation of continuous flux, both organizationally, and organizationally here we mean in terms of the global organizational networks, global communication networks, and individually, leading to a state of flux and to a precarious existence where nothing is certain, nothing lasts for long, everything changes fast, and everyone has to continuously participate in those changes. Everyone has to continuously be involved. All right. This brings our exploration of information networks and liquid labor to a close. If you have any questions, please reach me on Twitter at TedMitu. Thank you all for listening. And see you online.